Next on Unsolved Mysteries. When a woman falls to her death from a hotel balcony, police must decide if it was an accident or murder.
Lisa!
A small town in New England is shocked when a popular school teacher is murdered. Meet an 8-year-old boy who is preparing for college. What determines who will be born a genius? And a young mother disappears before testifying in court. Could these letters help find her? These are stories, believe me, you won't want to miss. I'm Dennis Farina, and this is Unsolved Mysteries. Agawam, Massachusetts, a small town near the western Connecticut border. At the Agawam Middle School, under a dogwood tree in the courtyard, is a memorial to one of the town's most beloved teachers. The tragic death of Lisa Ziegert changed Agawam forever.
Lisa was a very special person. She was bubbly, outgoing, full of fun. Kids, she always had a special rapport. They knew that she really liked them. I mean, and that she treated them like people.
Now, this happens to be a model of an apple blossom.
Lisa Ziegert had grown up in Agawam. After college, she returned home to teach special needs students at the middle school.
Petals would dry up, and this would become an apple.
I think of Lisa as a gifted teacher.
Something up here.
The gifted teacher is the one into whose eyes child can look and see a reflection of value. And you can't fake it. You either have it or you don't. It's a gift. And I think Lisa had it.
What are you guys supposed to read for biology? Do you remember?
Chapter 5.
All right.
On a typical Wednesday afternoon in April, Lisa left school and drove to the store where she worked from 5 to 9 p.m. At 5:30, Lisa's sister dropped by.
This one? It was easy talk. It was sister talk. It was a little after 6 o'clock when I left. And then I went home and she was fine when, she was fine when I left.
At 8:45 the next morning, Sophia Maynard arrived as usual to open up the store. She was surprised to see that Lisa's car was parked out front.
I saw her car. And then I remembered that it was Easter weekend coming up. And we had planned to stuff some balloons, and that's what she was doing there. So I really didn't think much of anything until I walked inside the store, you know.
Lisa? Lisa!
I called her name a couple of times, and I figured she'd just pop her head out. She didn't. I came behind the counter. All of her things were there, her drawings and her pocketbook, her car keys.
Lisa!
And then I just kind of freaked out. I knew that something was wrong, so I ran out, ran across the street to a restaurant across the street, and asked them to call the police.
Watch your step in here.
Police found signs of a struggle in the back storeroom and a few scattered traces of blood. Immediately, the FBI and Massachusetts State Police launched a massive search for Lisa Ziegert.
You wait to hear something good, but at that point, you start feeling that, you know, possibly it isn't going to be a good answer to what's going on.
I couldn't let myself believe that everything wasn't going to be okay, that she would be found, and no matter what had happened, that we would be able to have her back.
On Easter Sunday, 4 days after Lisa disappeared, her body was found in a wooded area on the edge of town.
She had multiple knife wounds around her shoulders and throat. And later on, an examination by the county medical examiner indicated that she had been sexually assaulted.
The outpouring of love and shared grief was overwhelming. At Lisa's wake, more than 1,000 people stood for 5 hours in the rain to pay her tribute.
It was just beyond anything I ever experienced. It just, again, showed us what kind of a person Lisa was. We're not a political family or anything, so there would be no reason they would come out for us. It was for her.
As the town mourned, authorities pursued their investigation. 3 critical phone tips came in that helped establish a time frame for the murder.
First call was from a person who had been in the store at 8:20 and had made a purchase and actually had a timestamp receipt.
Excuse me? Do you know the price on this?
It should be marked.
There was nothing that was unusual. There was nothing that was out of line. Nothing that perked their attention to say that they should call the police. The second person was a customer of the store who had gone in at 9:00.
Is anybody here?
She found it open, lights on, but nobody was around.
Hello?
This person told us that they did hear some noise in the back room. She described it as a banging noise. She waited a minute and nobody came out, so she left. This suggested to us that Lisa was in the store around 9:00 and in the back room. Further investigation revealed that she had been horizontal on the floor and there were 2 kick marks from her shoes on the bottom of the door.
The third tip came from a witness who was on her way home from work at 9:15 p.m. This witness saw what police believe could have been the killer's car. She also said that a man and woman seemed to be struggling in the back seat. The car pulled off the road, heading towards the area where Lisa's body was later found. At the time, the woman thought it was just a carload of teenagers and drove on. Today, the simple plaque in the courtyard preserves the memory of Lisa Ziegert for a new generation of students.
I think children always feel that nothing can happen to them. And when something happens to someone that so many of them knew, it brought it home that life isn't always fair and that you have to be extra careful. And even sometimes when you're extra careful, it doesn't matter. This cannot go unpunished. It can't be something where this person gets away. And the children have got to know this. If it's important for us, it's even more important for them.
Authorities are still looking for new evidence that might lead to the arrest of Lisa Ziegert's killer or killers. The vehicle seen by the witness was a late model full-sized Bronco or Blazer, either dark red or dark blue. If you have any information about this case, please log on to our website at unsolved.com. Next, 5 people vanish and all the clues point to one man. Cedar Springs, Michigan. On a summer night, 18-year-old Rachel Timmerman left a party with 43-year-old Marvin Gabrion and 2 other men.
I want you out of the car.
Some considered Gabrion the town bully, but he was friendly with Rachel's family and well aware that life had been tough for her. She had come from a broken home, and when she was just 17, Rachel gave birth to a daughter.
I said get out of the car.
Ain't no way, man.
I'm not getting out of here. It's in the middle of nowhere.
Get out of the car! Do it! Do it! Get! No, not you!
What?
No!
Guys,
go! Marvin!
Rachel later told police that Gabrion beat her, then raped her. After a 6-month investigation, Gabrion was arrested and then released on bail 2 weeks later.
That rape was so brutal, and it took a long time at the hospital, and the scarring, I don't think, would have ever went away. It got to where she didn't really hardly trust anybody unless she already knew them, because she didn't know who could hurt her again.
Rachel took a job at a local restaurant to support her 11-month-old daughter, Shannon. Nearly a year passed. But as the date for Gabriel's hearing got closer, Rachel began to worry about testifying.
She had told me that he'd threatened her numerous times. She was a little scared to go to trial, but I had talked to her about it. I told her, it's okay, honey. I'll go with you. I'll help you, and we'll do it.
She would have reoccurring nightmares. She was totally convinced that this man would kill her.
2 days before the rape hearing, Rachel took Shannon and went out for the evening.
Some guy.
Yeah, actually, he asked.
She came out to see me and told me that she had a dinner date with some boy. She was going to take Shannon with her and have dinner. She'd be home in a few hours.
A few hours passed. Rachel and Shannon did not come home. The next day, less than 24 hours after Rachel disappeared, her father received a letter.
This letter was from Rachel and basically said that she was going on vacation. We didn't know what to make of it. We were worried that it was kind of a goofy thing to do, that it just didn't make sense. Here, you just got a job at the restaurant, you're earning money. Why would you need to go on a vacation now?
June 5th, we had a pretrial hearing scheduled for Marvin Gabriel on the rape charge against Rachel Timmerman. And on that date, Rachel failed to show up for that pretrial hearing.
Because rape cases without witnesses are extremely difficult to prosecute, the charges against Marvin Gabriel were dropped. 11 days passed. Then prosecutor Crystal Roche received a letter signed by Rachel. It was sent from Little Rock, Arkansas, more than 1,500 miles away.
Dear Crystal Roche, Marvin Gabriel did not rape me. When he wouldn't have intercourse with me, I decided to teach him a lesson. A short time later, we made up, and I can't bear the thought of trying to lock up an innocent man. Thank you, Rachel Timmerman.
I didn't believe it. It didn't make sense to me. And I got angry because she was very serious about pressing these charges. I was concerned that something had happened to her.
That same day, Rachel's father received another letter. It was also postmarked in Little Rock, Arkansas.
Dear Dad, Shannon is doing great. She misses you guys, but she's adjusting to life out here really well. I don't know for sure yet.
The letter that I'd received was reassuring. It said she was okay, that her and Shannon were fine. They had a method of earning money. They were getting by okay, and that they would be in touch with me later.
More than 2 weeks went by without any word from Rachel. And then on the morning of July 5th, the decomposed body of a young woman was found in Oxford Lake, outside Cedar Springs. It was Rachel Timmerman.
She had been wrapped in chains with cement cinder blocks, padlocked to the chains, and duct tape around the eyes and mouth, and then placed into the lake.
The autopsy revealed that Rachel Timmerman did die as a result of drowning. She had been placed in a lake alive.
Police believe that Rachel Timmerman was murdered soon after she disappeared. But what happened to her 11-month-old daughter, Shannon? She was still missing and had not been seen in a month. Investigators called in a team of divers to search the lake, but they found no trace of Shannon. Though her fate was still a mystery, there was no doubt that Rachel had been murdered.
I am fine.
Authorities developed a theory. Whoever killed Rachel forced her to write the letters almost immediately after she was kidnapped, then mailed them after throwing her body into the lake. One suspect immediately came to mind, Marvin Gabriel.
We decided to go over to Mr. Gabriel's residence. Mr. Gabriel was not there, but cinder blocks were noticed that appeared to be the same as what was found with Rachel Timmerman when her body was recovered from Oxford Lake.
But Gabriel had fled Cedar Springs, and he wasn't the only one who couldn't be found.
It seems to be anybody that knows Marv and has any information that could be damaging to Marv comes up as a missing person.
Missing person number one, Wayne Davis. He had been in the car the night that Rachel was raped and agreed to testify against Gabriel. Davis was last seen days after Gabriel was released from jail. Missing person number two, John Weeks, an acquaintance of Gabriel's. Weeks had asked Rachel out on a date a few weeks before her death.
His name came up when we were attempting to identify the individual that might have picked Rachel up on June 3rd from the Timmerman residence. In our efforts to locate him, we've come up against a stone wall and found out that he also was a missing person.
The FBI learned that Gabriel had been using an alias, Robert Allen. Authorities discovered that the real Robert Allen had also disappeared. He was missing person number three. Update. Marvin Gabriel was eventually arrested by the FBI in upstate New York. He had been cashing pension checks payable to Robert Allen. Gabriel was convicted of Rachel's murder and sentenced to death. 4 months later, the body of Wayne Davis was found in the same national forest where Rachel's body had been discovered. Gabriel has not been charged in his death. Rachel's child, Shannon, has never been found. Next, police in California pick up a young woman who has no idea who she is. Port Hueneme, California.
Okay, smaller plane with the propeller in the front. The propeller's in the front.
This young woman was found wandering through the streets of this small coastal town. She was unable to speak or hear and carried no identification.
This is the baby?
Although social workers have been counseling her, they have been able to learn very little about her.
Okay, right.
The story begins on an otherwise typical fall afternoon. A passing driver saw the young woman acting strangely on the median strip of a busy street.
You don't hear what I'm saying?
Huh?
Do you live around here?
The driver quickly determined that this woman could not hear or speak. Fearing for her safety, he took her to the local police station.
Hi, what's your name?
Although police tried to question the woman, they too were unable to communicate with her. The only clue to her identity was a receipt from a bank in San Diego, 200 miles away. Police found no grounds to hold the young woman, and a short time later, she left.
105 North Avenue.
I'm 10-6 with the subject. I'll bring her into the station.
The next day, a patrolman came upon the same young woman once again in the middle of a busy street. This time, she was sent to a homeless shelter where she could receive help.
It's okay. It's okay.
When she first came to this shelter, she had no means of formal communication with anyone, and so a lot of it was pantomiming and mimicking and what is known as home sign language.
So this is a picture of you?
Chris Barrows tried to break through the wall of silence that surrounded this unique Jane Doe.
One of the first things that we tried to do was we wanted to get a name and an age so that we could find out if we were dealing with a juvenile or whether we were dealing with an adult. We sat down with paper and pen, and we tried communicating with her that way.
Let me try my name.
We wrote our names, Marty and I. I wrote my name, gestured to myself several times. Marty wrote her name, gestured to herself several times.
Who are you? You try.
And then we asked her to write her name, if she could write.
Your name, this is me.
Okay, I think she got it here. L, L.
In the end, the young woman was able to spell out her name using simple hand gestures.
When I copied it onto the paper, it was instant recognition, and in our field, instant recognition means this has got to be the truth.
The name she spelled out was Luxie, which may be a Spanish first name.
She got very excited when she found that someone finally had known her name and had gotten it. We did the same thing with her age.
How old are you?
10, 20, 2, 1, 23.
You're 23. Okay.
It seemed easy to determine the woman's age. It wasn't so easy to find a friend or relative.
You draw the baby.
These scenes were filmed with Luxie while she was at the shelter. Chris and Marty called her Lucy for short.
Although the genuine concern is for her immediate safety and her immediate protection, there are people out there who know Lucy, who have loved her in the past, who have taken care of her, and she needs to be with those people.
Soon after we aired this story, Lucy left the homeless shelter, and she has not been seen since. Authorities have no idea what happened to her. Hopefully, she has found her way home, where she is safe and well. In a startling experiment, Los Angeles County sheriffs toss a dummy off a hotel balcony. 9 days earlier, a woman had fallen to her death from the same spot. Investigators were trying to determine if her death was an accident, if she jumped, or if she was murdered. The deceased was Sandra Orellana. She had arrived in California on a business trip with this man, her boss, 33-year-old Robert Salazar. They both worked for Skillmaster, a national employment agency based in Houston, Texas. Sandra, a claims specialist at the company, was engaged to be married. Robert Salazar was the general manager of operations. He had a wife and two children. On the morning of November 12th, Sandra and Salazar checked into adjacent rooms on the 8th floor of the Sheraton Hotel. At 6:30 the next morning, another hotel guest spotted Sandra's crumpled body on the ground below. Police immediately questioned Salazar. He told them that he had escorted Sandra to her room around midnight. He stayed for only a moment, and when he left, Sandra was alive and well.
When Mr. Salazar first told that story, it was a believable story. It was only after the homicide detectives began looking inside the room and determined that his underwear was in the room that we did not believe him.
When police questioned Salazar again, he told a very different story.
He said that he had, in fact, gone into the room with Sandra and that they had engaged in sex. And that at one point they were on the balcony. Sandra had positioned herself on the railing of the balcony in such a way that she threw one of her legs over the top of the balcony and lost her balance and had fallen.
Sandra's family was outraged by Salazar's allegations.
Family believes that Sandra would never have engaged in any consensual relationship with Robert Salazar. First, she was very devoted to her fiancé. Secondly, she didn't believe in romantic relationships at work.
Salazar says that he and Sandra had not been romantically involved until that evening. Several witnesses confirm that the couple was seen in the hotel bar drinking, holding hands, and kissing. After that, Salazar told police they went up to Sandra's 8th floor room. A short time later, Sandra fell off the balcony. Salazar told no one about the accident. Instead, he simply went back to his room. The next morning, he was seen in the hotel lobby pretending to be waiting for Sandra. He even left a message on her room's voicemail asking where she was. Authorities used the dummy to test Salazar's account of how and where Sandra went over the railing.
The dummy landed a number of feet from where Sandra actually landed. close to 15 feet at one dropping, and another time I believe it was 12 feet. So it was never even close to where she actually landed. We tried it several times, and we actually ended up trying to make it land where she landed, and we had to basically throw the dummy in that direction to make it land there.
Police also noted that Sandra was just 18 inches taller than the railing. That made simply falling off the balcony very unlikely.
I don't believe that it's possible that she could have fallen off the balcony. I think that something else caused her to fall off the balcony that Mr. Salazar has not yet revealed. We want to get to the truth so that we can explain away all the questions. Whether we ever will or not remains to be seen.
Update. Nearly 5 years after Sandra Orellana fell to her death, the Los Angeles District Attorney filed murder charges against Robert Salazar. At the trial's conclusion, the jury found Salazar not guilty of murder. Jurors said the prosecution failed to make their case because no sign of a struggle was found in the hotel room. Next, two infants are sold by a nurse in Texas. 20 years later, they are still searching for their birth parents. San Antonio, Texas. These three infants were all born in San Antonio between 1959 and 1966. But they all have something else in common. All three were kidnapped by a nurse named Ethel Nation, who then provided the infants to unsuspecting adoptive parents for a fee. The shady business first came to light when the mother of this infant began looking for her. In November 1959, 18-year-old Dylene Zolikoff was alone, scared, and 7 months pregnant. She was taken in by a nurse in San Antonio, a nurse named Ethel Nation. Dylene gave birth to a healthy baby girl. While she was still in the hospital, Ethel took the infant away.
Ethel stole my baby. And I searched, I tried everything. I talked to a lawyer. Ethel wouldn't help me. Couldn't find my baby.
Ethel denied she had anything to do with the abduction of Dylene's baby. But in 1968, Dylene found a photograph of her daughter in Ethel's house. It took another 15 years of searching before Dylene and her daughter were reunited on national television.
She's so beautiful. Isn't she beautiful?
When I first saw my daughter, she smiled. And I was just overjoyed to finally, after all these years, I finally found her.
While the story of Dylene and her daughter has a happy ending, the stories of two other young people who were sold by Ethel Nation are far from over. Scott Mers was born in San Antonio in 1965. His adoptive parents were unable to have children and paid Ethel Nation a fee of $1,200 for Scott. Scott grew up knowing that he had been adopted. But when he was 10, he began to have a strange recurring dream. It seemed to be about the mother he never knew and just maybe the place where he was born.
I remember walking through the main doorway, feeling very cold. I felt like very, very horrible things went on there. Beside this table, there was a man in a green robe and a lady dressed in white. I don't know what they were doing there. When I woke up almost screaming. I mean, I was really, really scared.
When Scott was 18, he and his adoptive mother, Mary, began to search for his birth mother. They started with a visit to Ethel Nation.
She seemed really nice. Seemed like she wanted to help. Then, as the times grew on, it got worse and worse and worse.
Miss Nation, I just need to ask you a few more questions.
Scott and Mary met with Ethel 6 times. With each new visit, she changed her story. At various times, she told Scott that he had been born in 3 different hospitals, but none of them had his birth records.
They have no record of my being born there.
Who said anything about Santa Rosa?
You did.
On the final visit, Ethel lost her temper and revealed what she said was the bitter truth about Scott's mother.
Your mother didn't want you.
She told me that I was a bastard child, that all my mother was a slut, a whore, and that I should have no right to even look for her. So for me to go home and for me to stop looking for her.
Scott and Mary wouldn't give up. They visited the Woodlawn Clinic, another place where Ethel said Scott had been born.
The very minute that we walked in, I was completely stunned. I couldn't even talk.
This is it.
The feelings that I got from this were just incredible. I mean, it was a morbid type feeling, but yet I felt like I had been there before. And everything in this dream that I had back when I was 10, it was coming true before my eyes. I was so happy that it made sense of the dream that I had from many years ago.
But that was all he got. Although Scott didn't find his birth mother, he did meet a young woman who had a remarkably similar experience with Ethel Nation. Donette Barker was adopted in July of 1966 by a childless couple from San Antonio. They approached Ethel after years of trying to adopt through state agencies.
We have these 2 little boys here that are twins and this little girl over here.
Because my parents didn't expect that things would happen so quickly. They just thought they were going to go to see the baby, but at that point, Mrs. Nations told my parents that they could go ahead and take me home that night.
We can?
Yes, absolutely.
Honey,
is there a problem?
Thinking that they were only going to see the baby, Donette's parents hadn't brought the $1,700 in cash that Ethel Nation demanded as payment.
It's all right, we'll work something out.
In the end, Ethel accepted a 14-foot ski boat in exchange for the baby.
You can go ahead and take your baby home.
When she turned 18, Donette began to search for her birth parents. She found that her mother's name was listed as Gloria Cantu. The adoption papers had been notarized by Ethel Nation. Donette Barker's birthday is listed as July 21st, 1966, but she may have been born weeks earlier. Her mother, Gloria Cantu, may have been 23 years old when Donette was born.
You know, maybe it's something she's never told anyone or who she's currently married to if she's married. But I don't want anything, no strings attached. I just want to know what happened and how it happened. I would never in any way want to hurt her.
Scott Murs was born on August 5th, 1965, in San Antonio, Texas. His mother's name was listed as Joyce Coyer. She may have been 22 years old. Scott's adoptive mother, Mary, met her once and recalls that she was thin, with dark hair, and an olive complexion.
Is Ethel Nation here?
It's important for me to find her because there's a certain gap, a certain hole that's inside me that I want to fill. And finding my birth mother will do that.
Update. On the night this story first aired, several viewers called on behalf of Donette's birth mother, Gloria Cantu Martinez. A short time later, Donette spoke to her mother for the very first time. She learned that Gloria had never wanted to give her up for adoption and that Ethel Nation had tricked her into signing the papers. So, Donette and Gloria made plans for a long overdue reunion. Within a few days, Gloria flew to see her daughter in Washington, D.C. Their meeting ended 26 years of separation.
when I was waiting for her to come out, a million things were going through my mind. Just relief that it was over, that I was finally where I wanted to be after a long time of looking.
I just couldn't believe it. I've always wanted to find her and wonder what she was like, if she was married, if she had any children.
The reunion was made even more special when Gloria met her four grandchildren for the first time.
Hi, baby.
Donette's dream of having her entire family together had finally come true.
This is Michael.
How are you?
This is Tyler.
Tyler.
If you have any information that might help Scott Merz find his birth mother, or if you know someone who had a similar experience with Ethel Nation, please log on to our website at unsolved.com. Next, meet Philip Pauly, an 8-year-old genius. His amazing intelligence makes for a fascinating mystery. Denver, Colorado, home to Philip Pauly. He may look like an average 8-year-old, but Philip is quite literally 1 in 10 million. Philip is a genius. In fact, he is so smart that he's too smart for school.
If you need any help, let me know, okay?
Thanks.
Philip's mother teaches him at home because even programs for gifted students can't keep up with his insatiable demand for knowledge.
Well, I'm studying algebra and geometry and the Middle Ages and cellular biology. And in the Middle Ages, I'm working on the castle defenses.
It's not that Philip's dad or I are dumb, but neither of us have the IQs to match Phil. So to me, it was a gift to have a son like Philip.
From the very beginning, it was clear that Philip was brighter and more alert than most babies. At 6 months, he started to talk and had enough manual dexterity to remove the bolts from his crib. At 9 months, Philip displayed a highly mature emotional sensibility. At 18 months, Philip could already read. For his second birthday, he asked for a violin. Within days, he was playing simple tunes that he had composed himself. At the age of 3, Philip was studying astronomy. His hero was astronaut Buzz Aldrin.
Hey, Mom, let's go over here. There's more stuff.
Okay. By the time Philip was 4, the Denver Museum of Natural History was his favorite playground. On one visit, Philip asked the curator why a dinosaur's skeleton was missing several vertebrae in its tail section.
And the curator explained at the time that the dinosaur was too large for the area that they had designated for it, but with the new exhibit, they were going to get it correct and not to worry about it. But he was flabbergasted. He says, you're the only person that's noticed.
Research indicates that along with heightened mental abilities, child geniuses often show acute sensitivity to humanitarian issues.
He carries the weight of the world. He's worried about the economy within the United States and the government structure, as well as what's going on around the world and how it affects, how what we do affects other nations. There's times that he gets so consumed with these worries that he'll stop eating, he bites his nails, he loses sleep. I mean, these are things that we have to talk about, what he can actually do on a personal level to help mankind.
So where would you expect a child like Philip to play? On a basketball court? Not on your life. Try an archaeological dig.
Okay, there you go.
I think Philip working at the site here has fun. Okay. He knows it's important. He understands the value of what he's doing. It's intellectually stimulating, but he's digging in the dirt.
Philip enjoys a variety of subjects and tackles each one with passion. When we asked what he wants to be, he had a tough time picking just one job.
Paleontologist, an archaeologist, a conservationist, and hopefully I'll be the commander to the mission to Mars and the chief curator of the Denver Museum of Natural History.
Artifact number 23.
But what makes a genius? Is it nature or nurture? Scientists truly don't know. But some people believe that geniuses may possess knowledge and skills acquired in other lifetimes.
He told me one time that heaven had opened and he had looked down and he had chose me as his mom because I would be the right one for him.
It's clear to me that many, many gifted children come in knowing more than it would be explainable by scientific standards. Where they get that knowledge from, I don't know. But I would not discount any possibility, including reincarnation, that they're visiting us from more evolved cultures. Anything is possible.
Wesley?
Philip doesn't have much time left for childhood. In 2 years, he'll be old enough to take the college entrance exams. He plans to enroll at the University of Denver. After that, the sky's the limit.
So what are we going to go see today?
The Hall of Life, Science of Sports, and...
Exceptional intelligence like Philip's is a rare and special gift. The danger is that the talents of these remarkable kids often go unrecognized. Since this story aired, Philip Pauly has continued his remarkable journey. At the age of 11, he completed a 3-year internship at the Denver Museum of Natural History. At the age of 19, he became the youngest person to ever attend the Federal Law Enforcement Training Academy. Currently, Philip is studying theology and philosophy at England's prestigious Oxford University.